The book of James is often called the Proverbs of the New Testament. And even though it doesn't contain those little nuggets of wisdom that the Old Testament book of Proverbs has in little bite-sized helpings, this book contains great impartings of wisdom on a bigger scale. Even though it's only five chapters long, it contains big chunks of great wisdom information. It is written by James, not the apostle, but rather James, who calls himself here the servant of God. Presumably the half-brother of Jesus, and also brother to Jude, who writes later on in this Bible. James referred to himself as the servant of God. That's him. That's his authorship. His recipients are described as the 12 tribes, which are scattered abroad. 12 tribes is a slang, a synonymous used to describe the children of Israel, though here he's writing to Christians, and so it is generally assumed he's writing to Jewish Christians, those who are now a part of the spiritual 12 tribes, the spiritual Israel of God. That's how the letter begins, and we'll start there in James chapter 1, which begins with James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. How he introduces himself reminds us that he's not an apostle, or he would call himself that, but rather is just a fellow servant, which all of us are. Only 14 people were ever called apostles, but every Christian should be a servant of God. And again, he writes to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad. And that phrase reminds us of Acts chapter 8, verse 4, where the disciples who, when they were persecuted, scattered across the world preaching the gospel. And here we have brethren who are under persecution, as this chapter will explain, and how they handle their persecution will determine what their end result will be at the end of their life. And that's what James is writing about for the most part here in chapter 1. Verse 2 of chapter 1, James says, "My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations." And this word temptations could be translated as outward trials, not just inward temptations to sin, but outward hardships that come to Christians, outward persecutions. And James says that brethren should count it all joy. We should count it as a reason to rejoice when we fall into these various kinds of outward trials. Why should we rejoice? He says in verse 3, "Because we know that the trying of our faith works patience." We rejoice when we suffer our trials, because if we are faithful to God through those trials, then those trials will establish in us patience, the godly virtue of patience. And patience, of course, is the ability to withstand and to endure the hardships as they happen. So we'll endure this time with patience, knowing that the next time the trial comes, we can endure it because we've already endured the one trial. And we can endure the next one and the next one after that. And that leads to patience and this understanding of no matter how long it may last, we're going to get through it. Patience. But James adds to that in verse 4, "Let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing." The trial will, if you let the trial defeat you, your patience accomplishes nothing. If you have to, if you give up in the midst of the trial, if you yield to the temptation or yield to the outward trial, then whatever patience you had up to that point is wasted. Your patience is only good if you are perfect with it. By that he means complete. Let patience have its perfect work. Let it see you through the trial. So don't give up halfway through. That does no good to you or to anybody. Let patience have its perfect work, then you may be perfect and entire. You can be complete and whole, lacking nothing. And that leads him to say in verse 5, "If anyone lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given to him." If you lack the wisdom needed to endure your trial, don't just try to muddle through it on your own. Ask God, and God will give you wisdom. God is an imparter of spiritual wisdom. He seeks out ways to help his children get through their trials. So ask God for help. He gives to all men liberally, and then James adds, he upbraids not. That means he does not scold you for asking him for help. If you ask him for help, you concede that you are weak and that you need his strength. He's not going to attack you for that. He's going to bless you for that. Verse 6, "But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering." You have to be sturdy and stable, secure to the rock of Jehovah. If you are tossed and turned, if you are unstable, if you are wobbling in your faith, then God will not bless you. ask in faith with nothing wavering. And then James adds, for he that wavers is like a wave of the sea driven with the wind and tossed. You're like the house that was built on the sand, and when the waves crashed upon it, the house collapsed. And then he adds in verse 7, for let not that man think he shall receive anything of the Lord. If you're wavering in your faith, that is, you will not receive anything of the Lord. And what is it to waver? It's to give up in your trial, as he says in verse 3. It's to miss the opportunity to rejoice, as he says in verse 2, or verse 3, rather. Verse 2, yes. It's to miss out on God's wisdom and to try to find your own solution to the problem. Those are all examples of wavering. And if you waver, God will not bless you. And then he adds to that, James says in verse 8, a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. What kind of man is this? A double-minded man. A man who wants God's help but doesn't want to do what God requires to get it. A man who wants and needs God's help but isn't prepared to sacrifice in order to receive God's blessings. Let the brother of low degree rejoice in that he is exalted, verse 9, and then he adds to that, but the rich in that he is made low, because as the flower of the grass, he shall pass away. The brother of low degree, the humble brother, is the one who will ask God for help, and he will be blessed. He will rejoice because he humbled himself. He'll be exalted, lifted up by God. The opposite of that is the haughty person, the arrogant person, the person who relies on his own strength, or in this case, his own riches. He relies on his own wealth and his own power to get through his problems. He will be made low. The humble will be exalted. The rich will be debased. And then James gives an illustration when he says in verse 10, because as the flower of the grass, he shall pass away. And then to clarify that, he gives another illustration in verse 11. For the sun is no sooner risen with the burning heat, but it withers the grass, and the flower thereof falls, and the grace of the fashion of it perishes. So also is the rich man, as he will fade away in all his ways. As certain as the sunrise, and with it the withering of the grass, God will humble the haughty. He will bring the flower as quickly as it has risen down back to the earth. You puff yourself up, God will pop you and debase you, lower you, humble you. If you won't humble yourself, God will humble you. And then he adds to that, in the middle of verse 11, James says, the fashion of it perishes. In other words, the beauty of the flower is wasted when it withers in the sunlight. Well, the arrogance of man is deflated when it goes into the light of God's humbling virtue, humbling nature. And he says, so also shall the rich man fade in all his ways. So if you try to lift yourself up and puff yourself up on your own riches, God will humble you. Verse 12, blessed is the man that endures temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life. And this ties back to the beginning of the text. When you endure temptation through your trials, you will be blessed by God, and you'll receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to them that love him. This is the same crown of life that Paul spoke about in 2 Timothy chapter 4. The crown of life that was waiting for him at the end of his life. The victory crown. The wreath of completion of the race. You finish the race and you receive the crown symbolizing your victory. We will receive the crown if we endure through these trials that we are faced with. And then he says in verse 13, let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. Don't think when you're tempted internally that you're being tempted by God. These kind of inward temptations don't come from God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, so neither tempts he any man. It is impossible for God. He has nothing to do with temptation, the text says. And so God does not tempt you with sin. If it doesn't come from God, it comes from Satan. Verse 14, every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. His own lust. Satan knows exactly what to use to tempt you. He draws you away with your own lusts and entices you. He appeals to whatever it is that is appealing to you, lures you to the trap. Verse 15, then when lust has conceived, it brings forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, brings forth death. He describes it in an illustrative way like a birth. You have the union of temptation and action. When lust has conceived, which is put into action, you act upon the lust, it brings forth sin. And sin, when it is fully grown, from a baby to a man, brings forth death. And to that he says, verse 16, do not err, do not be deceived, the word means, my beloved brethren. Brethren, mind you, he's writing to Christians, warning them of the dangers of temptation and sin. Don't say a Christian can't sin or that a Christian can't fall away. That's what James is writing about. That's what he's warning about. Don't err, don't be deceived, my beloved brethren. And then he says in verse 17, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above. Temptation is from below. Temptation is from the devil. But every good gift and every perfect gift, that is from above. It comes down from the Father of lights, in whom is no variableness, in whom is no unchanging of his nature. Whereas earlier James had said, don't you waver, he assures us God will never waver, neither have shadow of turning. There's no shiftiness to his being. He's his ever reliable, ever present, ever helpful. Verse 18, James says, of God's own will begat he us with the word of truth. You had temptation and sin in a birth illustration. Now you have a different kind of birth, a spiritual birth, being begat of God through the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures, that we can be the first fruits of his creation. We can be newly born, that is to say, of a spiritual birth as children of God. Wherefore, my beloved brethren, that is wherefore, because we're born again, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. Like the old saying goes, measure twice and cut once. We are begotten of the word of truth, and so let us be swift to hear the word of truth. And then James says, slow to speak the word of truth. In other words, I should be twice hearing the word in myself that I should be speaking it. I should be twice over making sure that I'm following it, that I should be making sure others are following it. Twice to hear, once to speak. Swift to hear, slow to speak. Verse 20, for the wrath of man works not the righteousness of God, because God is merciful, God is patient, God is forgiving. We should also be emulating God and not be so quick to use the word of God to attack others. You're not doing this, you're not doing that, you're not following this, you're not following that. There's a place and a time and a place to help people find the truth, but we should be swift to hear the truth and slow to speak it. And to that he says in verse 21, wherefore lay apart all filthiness, lay apart all spiritual uncleanness. And the King James says superfluity and overflowing of naughtiness, of evil doing. And receive with yourself under control the engrafted word, the word which grafts itself, attaches itself to your heart, which is able to save your souls. That's what the power of the word is. It saves souls. But then he adds to that, it's as if one leads him to the next thought in verse 22, but be ye doers of the word. That engrafted word, be a doer of it and not a hearer only. Be swift to hear, he said earlier, slow to speak, but be a doer of the word and not just a hearer only. If you're someone who only listens to the preaching and doesn't follow the lessons, doesn't apply the lessons, the preaching's not doing any good. Verse 23, for if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he's like a man beholding his natural face in a glass. He's like a person who looks in the mirror. Verse 24, for he beholds himself and goes his way, forgetting what manner of man he was. He looks at himself in the mirror and sees the imperfections, and then walks away from the mirror, and then quickly forgets all the imperfections. He walks away from the mirror, and he doesn't see himself the way the mirror showed himself anymore. He deceives himself and tells himself he has no imperfections, and forgets that the mirror had exposed those imperfections. Verse 25, but whoso looks into the perfect law of liberty, if you hold up the Bible as a mirror, it will show you not only what you are, it will show you what you can be. It will show you you're a sinner, and it will show you how to become a saint. Look at the perfect law of liberty, and continues therein, that person is being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, and this man shall be blessed in his deed. Why will he be blessed? He'll be blessed because he looks into the word of God and becomes the man God wants him to be. Verse 26, now look at the opposite. If any man among you seem to be religious, a person who has a set of divine principles he follows. He seems like he has those, but he bridles not his tongue. He is not someone who can control his speech, which is a big theme in this book, especially in chapter 3. He says if he doesn't bridle his tongue, though he seems religious, this man's religion is vain. He deceives his own heart, in fact, James says here in this verse. He tells himself he's religious, but if he can't control even his own speech, from which it comes from, your speech does your inner man, then your religion is vain because your inner man is wrong. Last verse of the chapter, he tells us what pure religion is. He told us what vain religion was, a person whose inner man is wrong because it is revealed by the speech he talks. But pure religion, verse 27, an undefiled religion before God. That's the first thing you learn about religion, is pure religion, and undefiled is the kind that is before God. It looks up to God, God the Father, is this. This is what pure religion is. It is to visit. It looks outward to our fellow man. It visits the fatherless and the widows, to visit more than just to stop by and say hello. The word means to care for them, to attend to their needs. The fatherless, more than just orphans, those without guides, those who lack spiritual guidance. And the widows, not just ladies who have lost their husbands, but people who are just in need and who need assistance. To visit them in their affliction and to keep himself, it looks inward, this pure religion does, unspotted from the world. So pure religion looks up before God. It looks out to help those in need. It looks in to make sure that himself is unspotted from the world. That's pure religion. And that's how James ends the first chapter. Several little chunks of wisdom having to do with what we, how we respond to our trials, having to do with how we respond to temptation, having to do with how we respond to our own religious inclinations, whether it's pure or whether it's phony. So a lot of wisdom in chapter 1, but that's just the beginning of this book. When we come to chapter 2, we will learn about faith and how faith has to be put into action. And if it's not, if it remains dormant and inactive, then it eventually becomes a dead faith. And that's no good to God or to ourselves. We'll study chapter 2 next time. That was chapter 1 of the book of James. Chapter 2 comes next. Until then, thank you very much.